All right. So those of you who have not been sleeping, you're welcome to sleep through my sermon if you so need to. He needs a blanket and a pillow. Can someone get him a blanket and a pillow? All right. Well, good morning, church. It is great to see you all here this morning. And I would invite you, and I actually do invite you, to find a Bible if you don't have one. There's a Bible usually somewhere around in the chair back ahead of you, underneath there. And I want you to open your Bibles up to the book of Revelation, chapter 10. These next two chapters are wonderful chapters of inquiry as to what God is trying to say to his church. And so this morning, we are going to look at what has been called in my study the second interlude that comes between the sixth and the seventh trumpets. I don't know if you remember, but the first interlude came between the Lamb opening up the sixth and the seventh seal. And you'll notice a pattern. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 seals, interlude, seventh seal. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 trumpets, interlude, seventh trumpet. So you'll notice a pattern happening. It's not by mistake. The Holy Spirit is speaking. And so as we come to this, we need to understand the purpose behind the trumpets. And the interlude helps us with that. Albeit, it is a hard passage. The chapters 10 and 11 are hard to really grasp at times. I was struggling. But that's what the Holy Spirit, it's one of the things he does. That's what he's for. He said, Jesus said, that he would guide us into all the truth. And these things have been put into our Bibles, not by mistake or, you know, Jesus is trying to blow us away with how smart he is. It's nothing like that. That these images, these things that have happened during the interlude are written specifically for the church, that we might understand the time we live in and be able to respond in a biblical way. So I would just invite you not only to have a Bible in your hand ready to read, but also to just take a moment and ask the Holy Spirit to do his job this morning that you might understand, to clarify, to guide us. Take us by the hand, Holy Spirit, and guide us through your word. It's his word. He will reveal it to us. So just have a moment. If you and the Lord, help me understand, Lord. Help me understand. This is a good thing to do even when it isn't revelation and bizarre imagery and strange events. It's good to pray and ask God to help you understand the scriptures because they're written in the Spirit and must be understood by the Spirit and through the Spirit, the scripture declares. I would also like to encourage you, these next two chapters, there's a lot here to chew on. And I kind of feel a little bit like each week I have to do way too much backtracking to get to the point. So I would encourage you to spend the time online, all the sermons are there, go through and refresh yourself in the groundwork that was put into the first few messages. Because I don't want to have to do that again as we go through. And it's going to be really important that you do that, especially as we move on through chapter 12, 13, 14, 15. The groundwork that was done before will really help in that regard. So if you have some time, I would encourage you to go back and listen to those to help you get the groundwork of where we're heading, so that I don't have to spend so much time back there and more time in the current message. The last thing we were told before the scene change of chapter 10, so chapter 10 is a scene change, is that the purpose of the work of the trumpets that God has been blowing as judgment are partial judgments, one-third, upon the history of the world. And these, the purpose was to graciously bring repentance to the hearts of those inhabitants of the earth who respond to him But we found out at the end of that last chapter, last trumpet, that here's what it says in Romans 9, just the verse before chapter 10, a couple verses. The rest of mankind that were not killed by the plagues did not repent of the work of their hands. They did not stop worshiping demons and idols of gold and silver and bronze and stone and wood and idols that can see, that cannot see, hear, or walk. Nor did they repent of their murders, their magic arts, their sexual immorality, or their thefts. So the trumpets have come through. They've announced judgment as partial judgment of God on the earth, and yet somehow it is not caught. Now, as I've been studying the book, I want to just enter into a little personal thing here. As I've been studying this book, I've become more and more aware, and I have seen all the tragedies that are going on around us with fresh eyes. And I'm not just talking about the ones that might be on TV. There's a lot of tragedy that's going on in this world, especially in regards to Christians. We have out-edged all the other religions as the one religion with the most persecution against it. Did you know that? In the world. And as I look at these things, and as I understand them, and as I see now with fresh eyes what God is teaching the church through the book of Revelation, the calamities that abound, the corruption that is everywhere, the suffering from both natural disasters and from the cruelty of human beings towards each other, it's impossible not to see. But if you see it only through the eyes of this world, you're missing the point. And as I understand what the scripture is saying, the seals and the trumpets have been continually announcing God's judgments upon the earth, upon the inhabitants of the earth. And the seals and judgments have been all constantly announcing the presence of evil, demonic activity, sin that is abounding, and God is judging. And I am profoundly amazed at people who can find very new and creative ways to excuse all this and all that is happening. They blame everything else, even the climate, for the problems that we face. They blame it all on so many things other than what it actually is. They do not see or do not want to see the results of evil. And the answer to evil, which is God's seals and God's trumpets, blowing his judgments. It looks to me as though so often they are looking to put makeup on a pig. That's what it looks like. Let's make it look good. And they forget it's a swine. It's not meant to look good. They wink at what is obviously the consequences of sin. They laugh at tragedy and calamity that befalls others. It is clear that immorality is on the rampage in our cultures. It's clear. It's just as clear as looking at the TV or internet for 2 minutes. Not even. They will even go so far as to call evil good, and good evil. If you don't believe me, you just try and speak up the truth. See what happens. You're speaking evil to them. How dare you? And so this makes the messages that we have more profoundly important for the day and time in which we live. And this is from my own study. This is what I'm gleaning from this. And I hope and pray that you also are being caught up into this and that you are seeing God's hand at work through his demonstrations of judgment in the book of Revelation. In Isaiah 5, there is a woe. Woe to those of you who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and think they are so clever in their own sight. Does that not describe our world right now? This comes from Isaiah chapter 5, not Revelation. You might have put it right into the book of Revelation. Woe to those who are heroes at drinking wine, champions of mixing drinks, the party animals who party on while the judgments fall, who acquit the guilty for a bribe and deny justice to the innocent. Yikes. You could read that in the paper today. Would you agree? So does the book of Revelation have a bearing on what we do now? Yes, it does. It is for today as much as it is for tomorrow. And so, Lord, Holy Spirit, guide us as we see these things coming. These trumpets have been blown to seek to gain attention, to warn, impending, ultimate judgment is coming. But how does the world know that, I ask you? Yes, they see all the calamities, and some of them even get, you know, there's something going on that's just not right. It's wicked around here. But they don't have a frame of reference for it. How would they know what they are supposed to do? How would they know that these things are coming on the earth and God is expecting repentance through them? How would they know that, I ask myself and us this morning? How do you think they're supposed to know it? Romans chapter 10 says this, verses 14 to 16. How then can they, that's the world, call on the one they haven't believed in? How? How would you expect them to know that these things are God's judgment on the earth? How? If they don't believe in him, how can they call on him? And how can they believe in the one who have not heard? Some of them haven't even heard of Jesus other than a cuss word. And they don't even know why they use it. That's the only Jesus they know. Is the one that Frank uses every time he hits himself with a hammer. That's the only Jesus. And who is he? How will they know? How will they know? How can they hear without someone preaching to them? There's a good question. Who is the someone in that question? Who? Us. The ones who have been sealed by God, who are protected, who are being carried through all of these seals being opened and all of these trumpets being blown and judgment upon judgment coming upon the earth. We have been sealed by God, by his Holy Spirit, so that people can hear, so that we can be the someone who preaches. Otherwise, they won't know. And how can they preach unless they are sent? Ladies and gentlemen and children, today, as pastor of this church, I am telling you right now, you and I are sent. We are to go, as Jesus said, into all the world and make a mess. Make trouble, make everybody else feel judged. What are we supposed to make? Disciples. And how do you do that? How do you make disciples? Well, there's a blessing in every little effort you make. How beautiful, God says, are the feet of those. Have a look at your feet. Have a look at your neighbor's feet, not too long, because you don't want to look at them too long. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Good news. You and I have good news. for a troubled, desperate, broken, filled with hatred, biting one another, angry at each other, angry at everything, uncertain, full of hopelessness. We have all of that. And here we are on Sunday morning, getting our tanks filled, and then we get in our cars and we drive home and we only invite friends over who we trust, and we go on picnics with only people we know from church because we don't want to get tarnished by rubbing shoulders with wicked, evil people. No. Listen carefully to me. I am serious to myself. We must be the voice of hope in a hopeless world. Where else is it going to come from? Where else? I'm asking you. In your neighborhood, who else is going to bring hope? Who else is going to bring forgiveness? Who else is going to be the one to carry the message of hope and love and faith and grace and mercy and holiness and joy and pleasure? Who else if it's not us? If it's not us, who else? And so the interlude between the sixth trumpet and the seventh trumpet goes about answering that question in amazing imagery. Okay? Are you ready to begin? All right, let's look at chapter 10. Let's look at it first. I'm going to just read through it because there's a blessing in hearing it, according to the scripture. And then we'll make a few comments. We'll break it down. Then I saw, so it's a scene change. From the brokenness of the world and the unrepentant hearts, there's a sudden scene change. And I saw a mighty angel coming down out of heaven. Awesome. Some of you have said you've seen mighty angels in this room. That's cool. They're around. They're not just in the book of Revelation. He was robed in a cloud. I think we've heard that before. An expression of God surrounded with cloud. With a rainbow above his head. We've heard that before too. His face was like the sun. We've heard that before too. And his legs were like the pillars of fire. We've heard that before too. And he was holding a little scroll, which lay open in his hand. Some translations say a little book. I wonder if those of you who have the Bible in written form would just raise your Bible up for a second. Just raise it up so we can all have a look. Look at all the little books out here that are open. And he planted his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and he gave a loud shout like the roar of a lion. We've heard that before. When he shouted, the voices of seven thunders spoke. I wonder what that is. And when the seven thunders spoke, I was about to write it down, but then I heard her voice from heaven say, seal it up, what the seven thunders have said. Do not write it down. Oh, I hate that. I want to know what was in there. I want to know what those thunders said. But only John was allowed to see it. Isn't that interesting? I wonder why. Then the angel I had seen standing on the sea and on the land raised his right hand to heaven. And he swore by him who lives forever and ever. Who's that? He goes on to say, who created the heavens and all that is in them, the earth and all that is in them, and the sea and all that is in them. And he said, there will be no more delay. But in the days when the seventh trumpet is about to blow his trumpet, the mystery of God will be accomplished, just as he announced to his servants the prophets. Then the voice that I'd heard from heaven spoke once more to me. Go, take the scroll that lies open in the hand of the angel who is standing on the sea and on the land. You can't mistake him. Don't go to the wrong angel, the one that's standing on the sea and the land. So I went to the angel, and I asked him, give me the little scroll. And he said, take it from me and eat it. It will turn your stomach sour. Oh, good. But in your mouth, it will be sweet as honey. I took the little scroll from the angel's hand and I ate it. It tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth. But when I'd eaten it, my stomach turned sour. Then I was told, you must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, languages, and kings. Oh my, what is this all about? What do you think it's all about? Well, I think there's a couple of things happening here. The messenger came directly from God. That's why all those illusions, like robed in the cloud, God has talked about. That's the presence of God. He's shrouded in cloud. So he's come directly from the rainbow is where the throne, it was mentioned in Revelation 4, that the above the rainbow, around the rainbow, around the throne is a rainbow. Face like the sun, Jesus was described like that in chapter 1 of Revelation. Pillars of fire, well, that's how God led the people of Israel through the wilderness at night, through pillars of fire. Feet on both land and sea, well, this message is for all creation. The message is for all creation. I don't know if you remember Romans. What is creation doing right now? Groaning. What's it waiting for? The redemption of the children of God. It's waiting. It's waiting and it's groaning. It's doing more than that too, and we'll find that out in the next chapter. And of course, the roar of a lion. And we know that lion who's also the lamb, right? The lion, lamb. Who was slain. So this symbolizes the very presence of God. And God cares for John, and so he sent John two messages. One of them was for John personally. Nobody else gets to know it. FOMO, fear of missing out. Right? John got a direct message from Jesus. After the seven thunders spoke, he was about to write it down, and God said, no, this is for you. Don't write it down. You see, John needed to be encouraged. This happened once before. The Apostle Paul, remember, he was caught up into the third heaven. He saw things that he couldn't describe and wasn't allowed to describe. They were only for who? For Paul. They were to encourage him in his sufferings. And I think, if I understand this personal message clearly, I think what's happening here is God is taking care of his prophet. He's taking care of John. He knows what's coming. The Holy Spirit knows what he's about to reveal. In chapter 12, 13, 14, 15, he's going to reveal the beast. And John needs a little encouragement. And so God, the Holy Spirit, gives a little encouragement to his servant John. Hallelujah! And there's a great principle in this. You know, we're down here fighting the good fight of the faith. And sometimes we get discouraged, right? Nobody in this room gets discouraged. Oh, there are some of you that get discouraged. It seems sometimes like we're losing, doesn't it? Hello? Yeah, it sure does. And so sometimes the Holy Spirit just needs to come to you and bless you and encourage you. And you alone. If you try to share it with someone else as though they should have the same experience, it falls dead. But if God gives you something that's for you, it's choice. It's sweet. It's good. I don't know if you're here today and you're discouraged, or maybe you're facing a big mountain. God knows this, and he wants to speak to you. You know that whole thing about the seven thunders? What a cool thing. As I was preparing for this, I was directed towards Psalm 29. And wouldn't you know it, there are seven thunders mentioned in Psalm 29. Wouldn't you know it? The voice, it says in verse 1 of 29, or verse 3 rather, The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The glory of God thunders. The seven thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. So that's the voice of the Lord over the waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. The voice of the Lord strikes with flashes of lightning. The voice of the Lord shakes the desert of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord twists the oaks and strips the forest bare. All in the temple cry out, glory. Now, if that's the same seven thunders, which it very could likely be, they are directed specifically to John. Oh, Lord, give us all a word like that. Hey, the power, the majesty. He speaks, the thunders of things comes to your soul, and all you can do is cry out, glory, 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 glory to God in the highest. Glory. Need some encouragement? Let the seven thunders speak to you. Go to Psalm 29. Pitch your tent over the voice of God and try and walk away discouraged. I believe firmly that God always prepares his servants for what is coming. And I think John did not know what was coming. We can read ahead and find out what was coming. John didn't know. This was all being revealed to him. And he needed to have his spirit bolstered, just like we do sometimes. All right, let's carry on. So he swears by the Creator, there will be no more delay because the seventh trumpet is coming and the end is coming. However, we're only halfway through the book of Revelation, so it's not the end. Does that make sense? I am coming. There will be no more delay, except there's going to be a little delay. There's going to be seven more bowls of wrath. There's going to be other things we need to learn. So yes, it's true. He's coming. Hebrews chapter says this, don't waste your confidence. He's coming. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you've done the will of God and receive what he has promised, for in just a little while, he's coming quickly. He will not delay. That was written to Hebrews 2,000 something years ago. He's coming quickly. Here he comes. Oh, well, yeah, he's coming. It's going to take a while. Yeah. The scriptures does describe him as saying, well, a day is like 1,000 years, so I'll be here in a few days. Then he goes on to say, but my righteous ones will live by faith. If they shrink back, I will not be pleased with them. So this mystery is also mentioned by Paul. He says, I want you to know, I want you to come to complete understanding in Colossians 2, in order that you may know the mystery of God, namely, Christ, the Lamb. The mystery of God, the Lamb of God, the slain Lamb, is a mystery. Why? Well, because he's slain. He was on the cross. He died. Everybody in the universe, except for God the Father and the Spirit, thought, it's all over. It's finished. He lost. Enemy won. But had they? You see, in God's economy, this is a very important principle for the book of Revelation and for your life. Not everything is as it seems. There's more to it. There's something else going on. And the Spirit of God is hard at work. And what does he do next? He hears a voice say to him, go take the scroll that lies open in the angel's hand. So what does he do? He goes over there, he takes the scroll. But interesting, he asks for it to be given to him, and it's not given to him. Why? Why? Because the task of the church, the mission of the church, must be taken. It must be taken. We must decide to take it. If we don't, he'll go somewhere else. the spirit will go somewhere else. He will accomplish his will. But like Esther said one day, or Mordecai said to Esther, who knows, right, whether you've come for such a time as this. Today is your day. Today is my day. Today is our day to shine like stars in a very dark world. Today is our day. How do we do it? He says at the end, you must prophesy again. I love that. That whole thing of prophecy is a very unique thing. In the New Testament, prophecy branches. In the Old Testament, it was very specific, right? The prophets came, they declared God's word as thus says the Lord, and it was scripture. If you were wrong, you were stoned. You were taken out behind the woodshed and killed because you presumed to speak for God. So it was very serious. But in the prophecy of today, it is all encompassing. It branches out. It includes any proclamation of truth. It goes wide. Now, it can also have overtones of the Old Testament, as we see in the scripture, the book of Acts. One of the prophets' name was Agabus, and he had three daughters who were prophetesses. So there is this unique ministry gift that God gives to his people. But overall, this is what happened on the day of Pentecost. And it's so important for us to grasp. Why? Because it's about the pouring out of God's Spirit. Listen to what Peter quotes from the prophet Joel. I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Do you believe that? Well, some of you do. Your young men will see visions. That's cool. Your old men, dream dreams. God can speak through many things, visions and dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women. This isn't a distinct thing for men only, like it was in the OT. I will pour out my Spirit in those days, and they will all prophesy. All. Everyone. What does that mean? That we go around prophesying like the Old Testament prophet? No. It just simply means that we speak the truth to the culture. And when calamity happens, we're the voice that says God is trying to wake us up. He's trying to wake the world up to his grace, his mercy, his love, his forgiveness. That's our job. And we go as lambs to the slaughter, like Jesus himself was slaughtered. We go expecting the hardship, the suffering that comes from the message. You see, trumpets alone are not enough. Would you agree with that? Hello? The trumpets of heaven, of revelation, are not enough. Why? Because God calls his church into action. Not only to pray, because God is raining down his judgment through the prayers of his people, as we've already heard. Our prayers are important. When we pray what Jesus said, come, kingdom come, your will be done, that's powerful stuff. And he listens, and he acts based on our prayers. Your prayers are very important. However, prayer is not enough. Prayer is wonderful, prayer is powerful, prayer is good. Prayer to the Almighty can change things. It moves the hand of God, but it's not enough. What else must happen? We must consume the little book. Raise that Bible up again. Raise it up. That's it. There you go. Yeah, I see those Bibles. Yeah, I see it. Yeah, even phones. Yep. We must consume the little book. Say that with me. I must consume the little book. It will be sweet to your mouth. Even the Psalm 19 says, hey, it says what? Your word is like honey. In the honeycomb. It's true. Why is it so good? Well, why not? It shows us who Jesus is. It shows us what he's done for us. It gives us a map for salvation. It tells us about forgiveness, about joy, about pleasure. It tells us about right sex. It informs us of what happens for wrong sex. It's a guide. And it's not because God is some ogre looking to make your life miserable, like so many people think. These things are written for your good, my good, our good. It's sweet to us. It sets us free. It encourages us. It gives us direction. It guides us. This is the little book. Consume the little book. Oh, and then when you're finished consuming it and you go out to tell people about it, it turns a little sour. Just beware. It turns a little sour. Are you with me? When you try to speak the truth, get ready for pushback. Not only from people. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about spirituality. I'm talking about powers and authorities and the things that are in the universe that are evil. They come to bear. When you decide to open your mouth and my mouth and we say, yeah, God is real, this is a judgment from him. He's trying to wake us up to the fact that he loves us. You'd probably come to church more often because you'd be looking for solace. I really believe that. Because some people will believe. Hallelujah. Amen. Some people will believe. And other people are going to look at you, and there's going to be times when demonic forces are going to influence their mouth, and they're going to curse you. And maybe even more. Because the martyr clock is still counting. Did you hear that? The martyr clock is still counting. According to Revelation chapter 6. All right. I think that's pretty clear. So I'm going to read this again from Romans 10. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? It's impossible. How can they believe in the one they have not heard? It's impossible. Unless God shows up in a dream, then it's possible. How can they hear without someone preaching to them? Who is the someone? Turn to your neighbor and say, you and I are the someone. Go ahead, come on. Turn to your neighbor. You and I, you and I, you and I are the someone. You and I are the someone. How will they know unless someone preaches to them? Be anointed to preach in the name of Jesus. That does not mean do a sermon like I've just done. Yeah, nobody wants to hear a sermon. Even my kids used to say, Dad, you're now preaching a sermon. Oh, okay. I didn't think I was, but I guess I was. But go prepared to preach. Later on this year, we're going to have a conference on how to share your faith in a modern world. I encourage you to take it. If you can sweep time inside and things you're doing and come, it's in September, come. Be better equipped. The days are evil. Time is short. The devil is furious because he knows the time is short. And he will take it out on you. Believe me. Trust me, according to the scripture. But some will believe. And the word, the little book, will be sweet to them too. And it will turn bitter in their tummy. And when they go out, they're going to face the same thing. That's what's going to happen. And Jesus said, go and make everybody's tummy bitter. He said, go and make disciples. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them the little book, the scroll that needs to be consumed, so that they can go out and do the same thing that you've just done. Amen? And believe me, folks, I've read ahead in the book. I've studied ahead. Good news is coming. Lots are going to believe. Lots and lots of people are going to believe because the church is doing its job. Somebody say, amen. Amen. Let's sing a song.
Just one look on your face, just one glance of your eyes. My whole world is changed. My whole world is changed. Oh, I seek only to see your face. I don't want to go anywhere without you, God, without your presence. Oh, let me see your face. Beauty of your holiness, God. Take me into the holy place. Screw.